Hello friends, welcome to Biology Made Easy. Today I'll be bringing you the very second part of the translation in the prokaryotic system known as the elongation. We have already dealt in depth with the initiation pathway where I have described about the dynamics, the molecular dynamics, the panning out of the initiation in the translation system. How the IF1, IF2 and IF3 work out, how does the formyl, methionine, tRNA is formed. So those things were covered in the initiation part. Now, elongation. So in the initiation part, I had drawn the diagram of the tRNA molecule, the clover leaf structure, not the 3D structure, whereas the 3D structure is known as the L-shaped structure. So if you can recall the clover leaf structure, it has got the anticodon loop, the T5C loop, the D loop and the amino acid acceptor end and also a variable arm. So the tRNA molecule is almost 76 nucleotides long. In books you can see it's written till 90 nucleotides, 70 to 90. Now the D loop or the dihydrouridine, which is a modified base, the D loop of the tRNA is responsible for it to be recognized by the tRNA synthetase enzyme. That's the main function of the D loop. And the pseudouridine, the T5C loop, is responsible. Its main function is to make the tRNA bind with the ribosome. That's the main function of the T5C loop. Now, coming to tRNA synthetase, this very process is known as the charging of tRNA. This, how is an amino acid brought or recruited to the ribosome? So that process is known as the charging of tRNA. Now, first of all, the amino acid has to be attached with a vehicle. The vehicle in this case is the tRNA molecule, the transfer RNA molecule. Now, how does it all begin? So this is suppose the structure of, just assume that this is a structure of the tRNA synthetase. So there are two things, synthase and synthetase. Synthase, if you can recall, the vasodilator nitric oxide. So that is produced by the enzymatic action of nitric oxide synthase on the amino acid arginine. And here I have written synthetase. So what's the main difference between the two? The main difference lies in the fact that the synthetase enzymes use an energy driving molecule, either ATP, GTP, CTP, TTP or UTP. It would use ATP, an energy driving molecule, whereas the synthase molecules, they do not need any energy from ATP, right? So wherever you see any enzyme having the suffix synthetase, it must be driven by ATP hydrolysis. That's the mandatory function. Now, suppose it has got three groups. One of the group is responsible for binding to the tRNA. One of the group is responsible for binding to the cognate amino acid. Cognate means its specific amino acid. One of the group is responsible for the binding of ATP. And then in a multi-step process, what happens is the ATP is hydrolyzed into AMP plus PPI. Here, look here at this reaction, tRNA plus amino acid plus ATP, this is the very enzyme, produces aminoacyl tRNA, AMP and PPI. Here the thing is, AMP means it's breaking two bonds, the beta and the gamma phosphate bonds. So this energy is equivalent to the breakage of, you can call it, two ATPs, because you're not just getting ADP plus PI, you're breaking the beta phosphate also and getting AMP plus PPI, two phosphate groups. So after this very reaction, to the amino acid acceptor end, the CCA end at the 3' OH group, you have the attachment of the amino acid and it gets attached via its carboxyl terminal end. The amino acid has a carboxyl group and an amino group. So the attachment to the tRNA happens via its carboxyl end, not the amino end. The amino end is free for the nucleophilic attack, which will be shown here. Now, there are two classes of tRNA synthetases, class 1, class 2. Class 1 is monomeric, it has got Rossmann fold. If you have learned deeply about the super secondary structures and all, then you will get to know. The clash 2 is multimeric. It's dimeric or multimeric. Second thing, the class 1 tRNA synthetases, they attach the amino acid to the second carbon, to the second carbon of the ribose chain of the tRNA present at the 3' OH group. That's why it is 2' OH. Prime means of the ribose, the carbon present on the ribose sugar. And here the clash 2 tRNA synthetases, what they do is they synthesize the reaction and cause the attachment of the amino acid to the 3' OH of the last nucleotide present on the 3 end of the tRNA molecule at the amino acid acceptor end. So that's the difference which you can be inquisitive to know and which can be asked in various tests like CSIR, DBT or ICMR. Now, after this is done, the thing is EFTU, elongation factor thermostable. This is an elongation factor which is present in the prokaryotic system, in the Escherichia coli system. Now, EFTU binds with the tRNA molecule. Which type of tRNA molecule? Which is charged aminoacyl, or you can call it acylated tRNA molecule. Now, I think you are aware of the fact that various tRNA molecules are attached to their specific amino acids by their specific amino acyl tRNA synthetases. So one amino acyl tRNA synthetase isn't capable of catalyzing the reaction of the attachment of all the amino acids to all their respective cognate tRNA molecules. So it's impossible. So I'll be making a separate video on how the different amino acids, suppose serine is coded by 6 codons. So 6 tRNA molecules will have one tRNA synthetase. And how does that molecular dynamic pan out? How does one tRNA synthetase molecule attach or cause the attachment of the same amino acid serine to the different tRNAs? That is a huge question. Second thing, you might have heard about selenocysteine. It's a modified amino acid. How does that happen? So I'll be making a separate video on those intricate topics. For now, just beware of these dynamics and these facts. Second thing, here, this is the complete ribosome, 30S and 50S. Here I have written something known as peptidyl transferase reaction. Now, know for a fact that peptidyl transferase reaction is the property of the large subunit of the ribosome, 50S, in the prokaryotic system. And this is the case in both the eukaryotic and the prokaryotic systems. Second thing, this EFTU, elongation factor thermostable, brings the aminoacyl tRNA or the acylated tRNA to the A site. It binds with the aminoacyl tRNA. And it's a GTPase, it binds with the GTP and then to the aminoacyl transferase, forming this very complex, and brings it to the A site. At the A site, it confirms that whether the tRNA is making the correct bond with the mRNA which is already present here. Its anticodon loop is forming the correct bond with the codon present on the mRNA molecule. If that happens correctly, if that happens appropriately, then the EFTU GTP would hydrolyze itself and become EFTU GDP, and then this EFTU GDP would get released from this A site. Then what would happen? Then there is another factor known as elongation factor T. Elongation factor T comes and it has specific affinity for EFTU GDP, not GTP. So it binds specifically to EFTU GDP and causes the release of GDP. Now EFTU EFT, this is the complex which is formed next. And after this very complex, what happens is you have EFTU EFT. Now the GTP molecule, guanosine triphosphate, that molecule has a specific affinity for this very complex. Now EF2 GTP would be formed and EFT would be released. So this cycle keeps on continuing, keeps on repeating itself. Now thereby you can regenerate EFTUs and EFTU GTP and again EFT. So here the breakage of GTP happened, right? So you can call it GTPase activity. And then what happens is A site, P site, E site. At the P site, I had told you, I had made you acquainted with the very fact that the first amino acyl, you can say tRNA, which is the formyl methionine tRNA in case of the prokaryotic system, comes and binds with at the P site, because IF3 blocks the E site and this thing IF1 blocks the A site. Now what happens here, you can see both the tRNAs are attached to the amino acid via their carboxyl group. Now this NH2 has a lone pair. So this lone pair causes SN2 nucleophilic attack, substitution nucleophilic attack type 2 on the COH group, and then this entire amino acid would be transferred from here to here. So this N would still be present here. So the amino acid is synthesized, or the polypeptide is synthesized from the N to the C, just like the DNA strand runs from 5 prime to 3 prime. Because this COH group would get attached here, a peptide bond would be formed, and thus this N group would still stay here. So N to C, the reaction keeps on going. Now this P site would have a non-acylated or a deacylated tRNA. And this A would have both these amino acids, forming a dipeptide at this very situation or at this very point of time. Now, simultaneously the ribosome would make a jump, that is known as translocation, right? And translocation is done by a factor known as EFG. Which is again a GTPase, elongation factor G. This is responsible for the translocation reaction. Translocation means the jumping of the ribosomes exactly 3 codons. That's a huge molecular dynamic conveying process, you can say, because it's not an easy task at all. It's a daunting task. The ribosome jumps exactly 3 nucleotide. If it doesn't, it will cause frame shift mutations. If it jumps 4 nucleotides or 2, it would cause frame shift mutations. So it has to jump 3 nucleotides specifically and accurately and precisely 3 nucleotides, so that this deacylated tRNA would shift to E, this would shift to P, and the A site would be again vacant for the upcoming amino acyl tRNA, which would be recruited to this very A site via the EFTU. GTP. Now, in this translocation process, this EFG GTP would again hydrolyze its GTP to form GTP plus PI, that would provide it the energy for the translocation. Now, a question comes in the CSR examination that how many ATPs are used for the formation of one peptide bond. The correct answer to this is 4. In many books you will find 3, but as per the latest research, the correct answer is 4 ATPs. How? In charging the first tRNA, you have hydrolyzed 2 bonds, gamma and the beta phosphate, so that is equivalent to 2 ATP. Now second thing, for bringing that amino acyl tRNA, you have used 1 ATP equivalent GTP here. So 2 plus 1, 3, and for this translocation, we have used EFG, GTP, again hydrolysis of GTP, which is very, very equivalent to the ATP. So 2 plus 3 plus 1, you have 4 ATPs, which are used to form one peptide bond. Now, so that this very reaction happens in the prokaryotic and the eukaryotic system. The factors, they differ. So this very reaction is known as the peptidyl transferase reaction. It mainly contains, or it mainly is comprised of the SN2 nucleophilic attack. And there are three factors: EFTU, GTP, EFT and EFG, and GTP along with the aminoacyl tRNA synthetases, which are extremely specific and extremely versatile set of enzymes present in both the eukaryotes and the prokaryotic system. So I hope you have understood the contents. If you have any problem, do comment on the comment section below. If you have liked the video, then please do not forget to hit the subscribe button and the like button. And any kind of queries will be much appreciated and is always welcome in the comment section below. In my next video, I'll be dealing with the pyrrolysine, selenocysteine, and one of the things which I have not explained here, which is known as the wobble hypothesis. How does a codon contain a wobble? So those things will be dealt in depth in my next video. So hope you enjoyed the content, guys. Thanks for watching.